morning, church.
Good morning.
We'll start this morning with a scripture reading. Owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. For this, thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Thou shalt not covet. And if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in the same, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And I read to you from the book of Romans, chapter 13, verses 8 and 9, and may the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. Most Holy Father, we come to you this morning with bowed down heads. We want to thank and praise you for just being you. We want to thank you, Father, for forgiving us of our sins. We want to thank you for the love that you have bestowed upon us. We want to thank you for your word, Father. We want to thank you for the roadmap that you have provided for us so that we might learn to do your will. Father, we just thank you as we go through your word today. Thanking and praising you for those that are here, those that are on their way, those that are lost. Father, touch them and let them know that they can do nothing without you. Asking you to bless today in a mighty way. Stir up the spirit within us as we go through your word. In your son Jesus' name, we give you the praise and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
Our lesson today. It's entitled, The Widow and the Unjust Judge. We have 8 verses, so we'll go around the room, read these scriptures, and then get it right into the lesson. There's a lot to be brought out from this lesson today. So, Deacon Ridgeway, would you start this morning with the very first verse?
A parable unto him to this end, the man ought always to pay and not to
pray.
Faint.
To pray.
Pray, I mean pray, I'm sorry. Pray and not to faint.
Amen. And then, Sister Moses, would you like to read the scripture today? Do you have your Sister Ward, could you share your book with her so she can read the second verse? Regarded man. Amen. And Sister Ward, would you please read verse 3?
And there was a widow that in that city, and she came unto him, saying, Revenge me of my adversary.
And Sister Dorothy, verse 4. And would you read verse 5?
Yet because this widow troubled me, I will avenge her, lest by her continually coming, she weary me.
Sister Christina, would you read verse 6?
And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear along with them?
And Sister Gay, if you would read the last verse.
I said you that you were set down, never that when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find that on the earth.
Amen. The time is 18:30 and the place is Perea. Our golden text reads, shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Luke 18:7-8. Our lesson outlined is in three parts: persistence required, persistence rewarded, and persistence reviewed. How many people in the class actually studied this lesson? I didn't ask you that. I said, did you study the lesson?
Yeah, I'm trying to, but I...
Okay. All right. When you looked at this lesson, and maybe one reason why you didn't understand it was because the lesson, even though we were instructed to read the first 8 verses of Luke chapter 18, we had to go beyond that. We had to go beyond that. And a lot of times when you don't understand, you go before the lesson. And sometimes you can look after the lesson. You get a better understanding. Because the same thing happened to me. I can understand when you say you didn't understand. Because when I first read them 8 verses, I said, something ain't complete in this. And that's a clue. When you look at the very first verse, it says, and he spake a parable unto them to this end. So that lets you know right there, something happened before then. So when you look back at Luke chapter 17, and I'm just going to go through it briefly because, like I said, it's a lot in this lesson. You can go back and study it again on your own. But in chapter 17, Jesus was having a conversation. Remember, we were always talking about the parable. Always we're talking about the parables. And so Jesus was having a conversation with the Pharisees. Okay? And they were asking him about the kingdom of God. When should it come? So now we're talking about, when we look at our lesson today, we have to have it in our mind that this is tied in with the second coming of Christ Jesus. So some of you might have missed that, I don't know. But this lesson is tied in to when Christ returns. So you look back at chapter 17, and the Pharisees were questioning Jesus about when the kingdom of God should come. And in this part, he expressed that it's nothing that you can look for with the eye, because the kingdom of God is from within. It's already in the believers, the kingdom of God. He talked about when the Son of Man shall come back. And Christ was trying to tell his disciples that he was going to have to go through a lot of things before that time comes. the suffering that he was going to go through. And also for the Christians, we were going to face some dark days as well. So when we look at verse 1, it says, and he spake, Jesus spake, a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. So even back then, when they went through the dark days in the 17th chapter, it referred to Noah in the day of Noah and how all those people went about their business doing everything they wanted to do. But when the flood came, many lives were lost. Only 8 souls were saved. It made that reference. It also referred to Lot. And when the fire, brimstone, overtook that city, and they were given a chance, Lot and his wife, to get a chance to leave. But what happened? It says, remember what happened to Lot's wife. Remember Lot's wife. Genesis 19 and 26. She looked back and turned into a pillar of salt. So even in chapter 17, it makes reference to those that will be lost. It says in verse 35, two women shall be grinding together. The one shall be taken and the other left. Two men shall be in the field. The one shall be taken and the other left. So he's letting us know that those times still exist today. We're still in those times, the dark days. And so the premise here is when Jesus said that men ought always to pray, good morning, and not to faint. We've just gotten a Sunday school lesson, and we're in Luke. You got it. We just covered the very first verse, Luke 18 and 1. So, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Because, and we know it ourselves, we can pray and ask God for something. And if he don't seem to be coming soon enough, or, you know, seems like our prayers haven't been answered, we're quick to give up. We're quick to give up. You know, you're looking for a job. And you done put in applications everywhere. And nobody's calling. After a while, you're quick to give up. And you start trying to work things out in your own strength. Here, he's saying, don't give up. Today we have the same thing. We have our little kids that are so disobedient. We've done everything. We say, I know I've been a good parent. I've taught them right from wrong, you know. And they seem like they listen to everybody.
But you.
But you. And sometimes we get weary, you know. And we just say, I throw up my hands. But as Christians, we are being taught to don't give up. Don't faint. Lead and depend on the Lord. Rely on him. His time is different from ours. We learned that in scripture. Just hold on and hold out. Might not come when we want it, but he always on time. On time. And we have to stand on that. Even when times seem rough, seem like nothing is going our way. Looking to buy a home, going everywhere, bidding on the house. Every bid I put in, it falls back. Somebody else overbids me. But you have to look at it. God has something better. Just hold out and wait. Verse 2, saying there was in a city, now here comes the parable. There was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. Now that is the first part, but it doesn't give us the information of what her problem was, what her issue was. But it was something that she knew the judge could help her to get it resolved. She went to him. And the one thing we get from this very first part, it gives us the two people that this parable is about. The judge who was called unjust. Why? Because he didn't fear God. He was wicked. He was evil. He had no regard for God and no regard for man. And I'm telling you, a judge sitting in a judge seat, and you have to go before him, you really have to lean and depend on the Lord. Because the lawyer might be presenting your case, and the judge could be up there asleep. No concern, no compassion. My husband went to court one time and had a lawyer, was before the judge. The judge told the lawyer to shut up. No compassion. If you're not going to listen to my lawyer, what chance do I have? You're guilty already. So we really need to lean and depend on the Lord and trust that he will do just what he says. He is a just God. The first part, persistence required. So now they already, the stage is set here with this widow. And we'll find out exactly what the attitude of the widow was. Any questions or comments before we move on to the persistence rewarded? And remember, in this lesson, the key word is persistence. Persistence in prayer. So don't give up. Always pray. Sister Winston.
I like how Second Thessalonians 3:15 says, be not weary in well doing. Because see, whatever we do, he don't want us to get weary on this trip, but he let us know it's going to come. I like how it says again, in all your ways, pray without ceasing. For it's the will of God. In other words, no matter what comes, keep your focus. That's what the enemy comes to try to take you away from you. And that God has a purpose for those things happening in your life. So I looked at this here widow, and a lot of people don't even know what a widow is. And say how many we got in this church. You know, widows are people that they're married and lost their husband. They are a widow. And so therefore, this widow got in a situation. So we're going to run into a situation in our life. But don't give up. Keep on praying. And I mean, here's the tactics of the enemy trying to set you up. I don't care if you're going against it. And yeah, it said, obey them that have rule, but pray for them. As they bring in their accusations, you keep praying. God said, I will deliver. Not when you want, but I will deliver. Be persistent. It said, persevere. Keep on. Trust in the Lord.
1 Thessalonians 5:17 says simply, pray without ceasing. And that's what we need to do. All man should always pray. Persistence rewarded. Verse 4 reads, and he would not for a while, we're speaking about the judge, he would not even listen to her for a while. But afterward, he said within himself, though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. Now, we see the attitude of the judge. As I said before, no compassion. But because the widow was persistent, he said, I will avenge her, lest she weary me. In other words, she was getting on his nerves. She was getting on his nerves. And all I could hear in my head was, avenge me of mine adversary. Avenge me of mine adversary. Avenge me of mine adversary. Can you imagine something like that just constantly? It's like your kids. Mom, could I please have the keys for Friday? I want to go somewhere. Mom, you said you was going to think about me getting the keys. Can I have the keys? Can I have the keys? And finally you say, take the keys. Not because there's so much love or desire for you to, for somebody to have your keys in your car. But you're tired of them. They're wearing you down. They're making you weary. And that's the only reason why this unjust judge decided he would avenge her, because she was making him weary. And we have to see a contrast in this, because God is just the opposite. We never make him weary when we're praying to him. He wants us to pray to him. He wants us to have the faith and belief that he will answer our prayer. We can't always get an instant an answer. Sometimes it comes instantly. Sometimes we have to wait a while. But if it's his will, he will grant it. And when he doesn't, it's because it's not his will. And it's not the best thing for us. Sometimes we ask for things that are not good for us. The outcome is not going to be good. You wonder, well, why did he let me have that? It wasn't any good for you. You didn't need it. We talked yesterday about lust and how lust starts with the eyes, or the senses, the nose. You know, it might just be the sound of somebody's voice that you're attracted to. It might be the scent of their perfume. Somebody walked past you, you ain't even looked up in their face yet, and you say,
smell good.
Smell good. And not just good, good. You know, and it doesn't always have to be a woman now, because men can smell good too. And it does, it perks up the senses. You know, but sometimes, if that's the only thing that's attracting us to them, it might not be what's good for us. God knows. We don't, because we're looking at the external. You know, God looks at the heart, and he knows. We see people talking about a widow. She had a husband at some time or another. But now, in the word, what does God say about the widows? What does he say about the poor, the children, the helpless, the strangers? He always favors those. That's the kind of God that we serve. He says, show favor to them. I had a scripture here, verse 2. Talking about Deuteronomy 10. He doth execute the judgment of the fatherless and widow, and loveth the stranger, in giving him food and raiment. Love ye therefore the stranger, for ye were strangers in the land of Egypt. And this is what Moses was teaching the people, that God required. You know, look out for the widow. Look out for the poor. Look out for the strangers, those that are hungry and in need. God is not like this unjust judge. He did what he did, finally avenge her. But it was just because he wanted to get rid of her, he was tired of her, and she was getting on his nerves. But we know that we don't serve a God like that. Not at all. Let's look at Luke chapter 11, verse 9 and 10. Luke chapter 11, verse 9 and 10. You have it. And I say unto you, ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. God looks out for his people. He says, ask, and it shall be given. If it's his will, you will get it. He's not like that unjust judge that you gotta beg and beg for his mercy. He wants us to talk with him. Also, I want to share from our expository, like I said, it's so much here. I want to share the contrasting ideas. And in here, it says, talks about the contrasting ideas that we see in this parable. Among them is the fact that the widow was a stranger to the judge. He didn't know her. It doesn't say she had anybody to speak on her behalf. You know, sometimes we can find a lawyer that knows the judge. You know, they'll hold your case back until the right judge is working. You know, that's right. Whereas we are God's children. See, we, as the children of God, we belong to him. We're not a stranger. And she could do, all she could do was make a nuisance of herself. Whereas we have a high priest who represents us before God's throne. Isn't that a blessing? All she could do was hope the judge could be persuaded. Whereas we have the promises of God in his word. And we know that he is a promise keeper. She came to a court of law. We come to a throne of grace. I thought that was neat, the way they made the contrast between her and who she was dealing with and God's children, and how we have God that we can go before in prayer. And one last thing, I talked in the beginning about those other scriptures in the 17th chapter. And I spoke about the dark days that Jesus knew that were ahead of them. And also is ahead of us today, the dark days. And that's why he told them that men ought to always pray. Don't give up, don't faint. There are dark days ahead, but with the help of the Lord, we can make it through. He does not want any of us to give up. So when we speak of the dark days, and our expository says not long after telling of this parable, Christ would be crucified and raised from the dead. Within a couple of months of the church, the church would be born on Pentecost. Growing rapidly at first, the church immediately came under persecution. those were dark days. Those were dark days. At the beginning, the persecution came from the same people who crucified Christ. As time went on, though, persecution arose from many quarters. By the end of the New Testament era, Christians were the target of official Roman persecution. This would continue for centuries until Christianity was legally sanctioned. Today, followers of Christ are still suffering. For what? For their faith. Christians still suffering. Thank God we don't go through a lot of that here in the United States. Even in nations with a Christian heritage, true disciples of Christ are harassed and ridiculed. Judicial decisions often limit religious freedom and encourage immorality. So the elect continue to cry out to God for justice. And when we speak of the elect, we're talking about chosen. Those of us who are chosen by God. Christians, His children, we still cry out. We cry out, but we should be, every time we see our young black lives lost on the street, from 13 and maybe younger, all the way up, never even having a chance to live, wayward, and shot down, killed, whether it's from their choosing or some mistreatment from the police, or whatever the situation, it's still a loss of life. We cry out. We cry out when we're looking right in our midst and people don't understand how good God is. They choose to live a different life. They choose to be like those same people that were around Noah in his day, when he kept telling them, the flood is coming, the flood is coming. And they were busy partying and having a good time and ridiculing Noah. They laughed at him. Yeah, that's what you say. Look, you've been building on that ark for how many years? But as scripture says, until the flood came. When the flood came, I didn't see in scripture where they say anybody was laughing then. It was too late.
Yeah.
Same situation today. How many of us are praying for our children? You want everybody, and not just your children, but all everybody that you know. And we should pray for all to be saved, to come unto God. But sad to say, that in the second coming, everybody is not going. They're not going to receive him. We hear about the Antichrist. Some will be lost. You look in our churches now, we see just a few people in here. It's going to be the same way. We have a big job ahead of us. I spoke the other week about the need for us to witness. When I see in scripture that Peter asked Jesus, how many times should I forgive? 7 times. And he was told, no, 70 times, 70 times. And the same with us witnessing. You wonder, how many times should I take the time to tell somebody about God? Tell somebody that there's another way. We should not get weary. That's why we come and learn more about what God has to say about things. We should all be telling somebody about God's word, how good he is, how he's a healer. He can do anything but fail. We can go to him anytime. There's no certain time. The church doors may be locked and closed, but God is always here for us. We can go to him any time. resistance rewarded on both ends, from the unjust judge and from God, a contrast. For a Christian, we don't have to beg, because God is there for us, and all he asks us to do is believe and have faith that he will answer our prayers. We will cry out to him. Some things man can't help us with. You know, we try to help ourselves, but nah, go to him and pray. Any questions or comments? Persistence rewarded.
People, it's sad because in this society, people don't want to hear about God. They just simply do not want to hear it. And they, you can go to them and you can try to talk to them, and they look at you and they think you're crazy. And they just simply do not want to hear it. And it has gotten to the point where people don't even believe that is a God, because they hear so much stuff. You know what I mean? They hear so much stuff all the time when they come to God. And they, and you get these people, they be reading and talking all that stuff, and people just don't believe it. I was reading that a lot of Christians, they are walking away. They are walking away because of so much harassment toward them. So they don't speak out because they're afraid to speak out. And so what do you do other than go to God in prayer? You have to go to God. You have to really keep God in your mouth 24/7. Because of the circumstances and the conditions that we are going through now. Remember last year, you were from there with the guy in North Carolina? He was the Bible study with these people in their church, and he turned around and killed them. So people just, they just really, Christians is really afraid now to just really come out and speak, because if you try to talk to somebody about God, they just look at you like they're crazy. They go in this ear and right after next ear, because they don't want to hear.
And what you said is the truth, but remember, it's no different from what it was in the Old Testament.
That's true.
People, the attitude was the same.
Right.
And the attitude is the same today.
Right.
But we are instructed as Christians.
Yeah.
And we know that God is not the author of fear. Pastor talked to us about that yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when we fear, fear is brought to us from who?
The enemy.
The enemy. That's right. And so we have to do, be obedient to God's word. God tells us how to remedy. When we speak to people, we're not to force them to accept or believe anything we say. In the Old Testament, what did he tell the disciples? Tell them what I say. And if they don't want to listen,
walk away.
Dust your feet off and
walk away.
See? But at least you've done what you were called to do. You've done that.
The second section I was looking, it reminds me of, you said something. This unjust judge said he's going to get weary. And you said, God does not get weary. Now, also, it says not to faint in the first section. So, first section is not to faint, but believe. And that's basically our job. Once we pray, it's believe. You don't have to ask for the same thing 37,000 times. But what you could do is say, Father God, I thank you that you have heard me, and that you, and I know that what I ask for is going to manifest. I thank you. Because look at Abraham. He never saw that. What did he see? He did not receive those promises that God had given to him. His seed did. So it just, when I see that second section, I think that people think that you gotta You got to sit there and just continuously pray to God, ask for the same thing 30,000 times, and praise when he says, okay, I'll give it to him, I'll give it to him. That's not the way
that
God works.
That's not the way he works.
Thank him. Thank him before, thank him that, and when it manifests, there you go.
That's right, because if what you're speaking of is faith.
Faith
is the substance
of things hoped for,
evidence of things not seen. See, so when we pray to him, we have to believe that he is going to answer our prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, as you said, it might not be in our time, but it'll be answered. It's in his time.
And you said that we didn't, like you said, persistent, praying, persistent. But also, people are afraid, but we don't supposed to be afraid. We're supposed to be persistent people. You know, that God is good. God is good. We are blessed. And all of us are sitting this morning, you see it. We're in a place that, you know, they're not cutting our heads off and all that stuff. You know, in Europe or whatever, you know, the Asians and stuff.
That's right.
So, you know, we're free to go around. You know, somebody might throw a rock at you or talk about you. You know, step back or hide behind the thing when the witness is gone, you know. At least they're persistent in coming and knocking on your door.
And we are that living witness.
We are.
See, and that's what people need to see. Mm-hmm. They need to see that light that's within us. Mm-hmm. When we witness to them, we have to be that witness. Mm-hmm. We have to be the one. You know, our testimonies, they're so important. You know, when we testify, we should be saying what God has done in our lives, because that's what people want to see. You know, when I can stand and say, hey, I had a situation in my back. My legs and my feet started to get numb. I went to a neurologist. They did an MRI. And they said, you have to have surgery. How many people would run from that? Fear. Oh, no, I'm not going to let nobody cut in my back. But I had to pray to God. And I said, God, you know what I need to do. Guide me. And he did. He led me right on in there. And I trusted in him that whatever they did, they explained the surgery to me, that I was going to come out just like new. And I believe that, because if I didn't, fear would have overtaken me, and I would have said, nah, I think I'll just deal with the misery.
And been worse.
But you got to trust God.
You ask God to do something for you, and they don't have to do anything. You know what I mean? You got to have faith in him, and he's going to do what he said.
Yeah, you have to be that living testimony.
That's a man, bro, that did not just stuff that so back with him.
Exactly.
And sometimes he's working on it. And we give him a glory, even though he gets glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Because he's working on it.
He's working on it.
For you.
Yes.
And he gets the glory.
Yes.
Out of it all.
He gets the glory.
He's going to get the glory.
That's right.
So we have to praise him and hallelujah. Thank him. Because he made you. Knows what's good for you.
That's right.
You gotta be careful what you pray for, because when you pray on what you do,
you break your
you're gonna be sorry.
That's right. And when you get out of his will, then you'll get the wrong thing.
Right.
You hear about people, oh, I need a husband. Do you? Some people don't. You know, but you can't tell them that.
No.
You can't. Some people really don't. And it's not for everybody. We see some people that are their wombs are barren. They don't have children. But God uses them to look out for the little children. See, and so we have to have a vision that goes far beyond what the eye can see. You know, so just because you don't have children doesn't mean you don't have that nurturing instinct.
Right, and love.
Right, because so many children out here that can be adopted. They need parents. And Sister Winston, before we move on to the last part, Persistence review, verses 6-8. And the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge saith. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? So if an unjust judge said, I will avenge her enemies, or whatever she's going through, her adversary. If an unjust judge would give in for whatever reason that he did, what do you think about our God, the one that chose us, the one that knew us when we were still in our mother's womb? What do we think about him? He's right there for us. He's the one that said he would never leave us nor forsake us. Yes, he's even greater. It says here, he knows that we cry day and night unto him, though he be along with them. And then for that, I had two scriptures, Romans 1 and 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. He didn't leave any of us out, not any. And then let's quickly turn to 1 John, the epistle, John in the back of our Bibles. 1 John chapter 5. Verses 14 and 15. 1 John chapter 5. Verse 14 and 15. It reads, we know that we have passed from death unto life, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth. I'm sorry, went the wrong place. 1 John 5:14-15. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. Some things we ask for are not according to his will. And you might need to be thankful that he didn't get it.
Yeah, right.
And if we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire of him. And last but not least, I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. When God comes to avenge, he will avenge speedily, very quickly. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? Will he find faith on the earth? I believe he will. Just like you see the few of us here, it might be a few, but there will be some. There will be some. And I want to share this with you. First, I have scripture here, which was Hebrews 10:37. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come, and will not tarry. he will come speedily. Okay? Now, the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. And let's look at Luke. We're going to go back to Luke chapter 17. I'm going to just, because we went through some of this, so I'm just going to do verses 36 and 37, because he was talking about how some will be received and some will be lost. He showed the comparisons right above that, coming down from 33. But in 36 it says, two men shall be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. And they answered and said unto him, where, Lord? And he said unto them, wheresoever the body is, there will the eagles be gathered together. So wherever we are, we'll be gathered together. Some will be taken, some will be left behind. Why? Because they didn't accept Jesus Christ. Here, there will be believers on earth when Christ returns, but there they will be few. As the preceding section indicates in chapter 17, verses 20 through 37, it will be like the days of Noah. We know the story. And Lot. In both cases, only a few were saved. That's sad, isn't it? Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. When we speak of the Son of Man, we're talking about Jesus Christ himself. Indeed, a great apostasy will occur before the end of time. And knowing that, that's another reason why we should always pray. Don't give up. Don't give out. Know that there is a God. Know that his word is true. And whatever, you know, when we speak, we shouldn't have to be so explicit. The scripture is very simple. And we should say it simply, the same way God says it. Because really what you want people to understand is his word. And once we get an understanding of his word, then we are obligated to do it. Do what the Lord says do. When we see and hear about the stories of Jesus and how he walked the earth, and we know that everybody didn't accept him. They followed him for what? His miracles. They heard he was healing people. That's what they followed him for. He knew it. But he came and he prepared his disciples. He knew he wasn't going to be here long. And he told them, you're going to have many more things to do. And that's us now. We have so much more to do. We can start at home. We can start at work. You know, we can start wherever. When people come to you and they're talking to you in a worldly fashion, you can turn that worldly fashion into something spiritual. And tell it simply so that they can understand. Tell them what the Lord said. It's not what I said or what you said or what we think. It's what he says.
You're not so people are saying that a lot of people don't want to hear. You know, I tell you what I have found, and I found it like going to ECMC. A lot of people that you might say something about the Lord and you'll be surprised how they respond, because they just don't talk about it out.
Exactly.
But they'll talk about it in close, you know what I mean? They'll talk about it like one-on-one in a closeness. so they'll do it that way. Even my van drivers. My van drivers do the same thing. They'll say, how you doing this morning? And I said, I'm doing fine with the will of God. And then they have this stuff on the radio and they'll say, God, you go to church? I say, yeah. And then they start talking about fire.
But when I'm thinking about something that you love, I talk about them all the time. It's like if you have a friend, somebody that did something, you just talk about them. Mm-hmm. But when you don't talk about them, he's not, you know, you got to be in your heart.
He said, you'd be ashamed of me. He'd be ashamed of you. So you have a friend that you don't talk about, he gave you, you woke you up this morning, you got a job, you can do, you don't want to talk about him. And you know, when you bring that friend around and you say, Sister Prince, I want you to meet such and such, then I can say to that friend, you know, I know so much about you, but that's because you've expressed
To me about your good friend. That's what the Lord. The good friend. And that's what the Lord. People don't want to, they don't, how can you keep them so close then? Yeah. But you know what, and I get to you too, Sister Porter. Some of you heard our son, the youngest one, used to come around and he was getting very curious about the Lord, but in my frame of mind he was going about the wrong way. Because he was looking at a whole lot of stuff that was coming through on TV talking a whole lot of, you know, stuff that a lot of it wasn't even in the Word, or it was turned around. And you're talking about persistence. We had to be persistent with him. Because every time he came in the house, he came right, he got right into those conversations, you know, and it, to the point, if you just, you had to be rooted and grounded because he would get bring something up in you, you know. But we kept on and kept on and kept on until finally he started coming our way. And he started realizing it was what's in the Word, not always what somebody else telling you on that television, you know.
The Word.
Yeah, talking about lost books of the Bible. I said, don't worry about those. You worry about the ones that's found. And now we ain't worried about the lost books. Sister Ward.
I was just saying that it took Noah 120 years to build that ark. But he did not stop telling those people. No matter how much they laughed at him and made fun of him, he still was telling the people about the Word of God. So if we run into people that don't want to hear it, it's not for us to keep our mouth shut about it. We still constantly let them know that it is the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Because it's going to be a lot of people that don't want to hear the Word. But it's not for us to shut our mouth. We got to keep it going.
We got to
keep it going about Jesus Christ and nothing else. When you let everything else get in the way, then that shuts it down. But you keep it going with Jesus Christ. And that's it. That's
right. And with the Word and us being a light, that puts the icing on the cake. Because once you share the Word, now people are looking at you. Are you doing the Word? Are you showing love? Are you somebody that's always murmuring and complaining? You know, are you trusting in God?
I used to go to lunch with a bunch of sisters. We used to talk about the Lord all the time. And this one sister, she used to use four letter words. And she said, do we have to talk about him today? I'm like, you have to tell me. I don't know. How can we not talk about him? Well, today she ended up being a minister.
Praise the Lord.
She ended up being a minister. Out of all of that, I don't know how it came to be, but I went to her first sermon. But she used to use four letter words. But when she said, do we have to talk about him? But we love talking about it.
That's right.
It's going to shut them
and
down.
And God heard her when she asked that question, too. And I can imagine his answer was yes.
Right.
And with that, we're going to close because we're at the very end, I believe.
Yes. All right. Lord, Father, once again, we come to you this morning by thanking you for another good day that you have. Open up our hearts and our minds and our mind, Lord, so we can understand your Word, continue to bless the teachers. Continue to teach us.
Amen.